research scientists here at IBM. Our research agenda is around visualization of data, data visualization. More specifically, we're interested in democratizing visualization. So that means bringing it out to the web and making it available to everyone and anyone.
One of the things that we're doing right now is a sort of a big online experiment called Many Eyes. And this is kind of the living laboratory that we're using to do a lot of our research. It's a site online that anyone can go to. It's up in public, and for free, you can put your data up and visualize it. So you can, if you have an Excel spreadsheet sitting around with something of interest, or you can write something up in a little word processor, you can just put it on our site, and then you can apply a bunch of, you know, fairly sophisticated visualizations to see if you can see new things in it.
Basically, half of our brain is hardwired for vision. Vision is the biggest bandwidth that we have in terms of sensory information to the outside world. So what visualization is doing is that it's just taking advantage of the fact that we are so programmed to understand the world around us in terms of what we see.
I think the best way for people to learn about visualizations is to make them. You know, it's the same way that people learned about typography and desktop publishing, by actually having at their hands a whole bunch of fonts to try. And, you know, there were some ugly results at first, but now people are actually pretty good at it.
The thing that you're trying to do with visualization, where you're taking data that may be very basic, may be very mundane, and instead you're trying to turn it around and turn it into something that's a little bit different, or put a different perspective on it outside of just the sense of, well, it's a lot of numbers and it's very complicated, and what can we do to kind of either get across that sense of wonder, or more important for me personally is trying to get people more curious about, you know, the particular topic. The thing is, for visualization, we actually need it to be a lot more like art and a lot more like writing than we do right now, where it's a lot about programming and a lot about, you know, sort of the visual aesthetic of how it looks, as opposed to what we're actually conveying and, you know, the way that we can actually do that, you know, what's actually effective.
So yeah, what I'm going to show you guys is a bunch of data visualization software that I've written. Basically, I write computer software that takes a bunch of different types of data and turns it into something that we can relate to easier. This is one of the projects, the first data visualization projects I worked on. This is looking at air traffic over North America for a 24-hour period. So I think it's one thing to say, like, you know, there's 140,000 planes in the sky above us, and that kind of registers, but at the same time, if you can see the kind of ebb and flow of the system, you can make insights about, like, population distribution, about the infrastructure, about kind of the decisions that are being made by air traffic controllers. And this is a more granular data set looking in specifically at Florida. This is the blue represents higher altitude and white represents lower. So you can actually see the ways the airplanes are taking off and landing in different regions. So that's Florida. This is Southern California. Get the no-fly zone in Nevada and Los Angeles and San Francisco. This is Atlanta, which is kind of a major shipping hub. So all the FedEx packages and coming into one location. This is New York. And you can see kind of the chaos that air traffic controllers are dealing with in that region. It's like heavy flows.
So here's one quote from Google's chief economist, Hal Varian, that I like. I think illustrates some of the problems that we try and tackle in our group's research. And that's that the ability to take data and be able to understand it, to process it, extract value from it, visualize it, and communicate it, that's going to be a hugely important skill in the next decades. Because now we really do have essentially free and ubiquitous data. And basically this creates a complementary scarce resource, which is our ability to use this data effectively.
The amount and the access to different kinds of data from different places is exploding and is really new. Everything from data.gov, where you got the federal government that's actually releasing data in a fairly raw format and really isn't trying to spin it in any kind of way. They're saying these are the numbers, do with them what you will. That's really interesting. We're trying to figure out ways to build interesting things around it.
It's obvious that we have a significant data problem, and that's simply not going away. You know, we can run numbers about it, we can throw heavy statistics at it, we can do data mining, we can do all these other things, but that doesn't cross over to the, you know, the human side of it, where things get a lot more interesting.
So in media, I'd say we're always excited to see what the New York Times is up to. They are pushing the envelope. It's great to see that they are actually putting out some visualizations that are quite sophisticated that we can see, you know, they trace back all the way to academia.
I mean, charts are data visualization. So we've been doing data visualization, and many other people have been doing it for a long time. What we're doing now and the way that, you know, data visualization as a discipline, how, you know, that's kind of evolving and growing, it's a little bit different from what we've been doing in the past.
I was very impressed when they had the Voronoi diagram of all the little pieces of the economy.
The data by nature is hierarchical, right? And so, like, you have, like, you know, food and then meat and then types of meat. It's also things you can relate to, like, as opposed to inflation being a abstract, weird concept. Just by the structure of the data, it was pretty clear that, you know, a tree map would be a good solution. And I, you know, made, there's, you know, well popular software now to make square tree maps. It seems sort of unfriendly and unsatisfying. And so I just started looking around for people who have done different things. Michael Balzer, he was at the time, he was doing, I think, a postdoc in Germany, and that was what his research was about. So I reached out to him for some help.
Amanda, I forget who, it was someone who was commenting on a blog or a blogger who said that she was the queen of InfoViz, which is kind of hilarious and I think also true.
Amanda studied statistics in college, and she's brought both a little bit more of a focus on data to the department and also just some sort of an amazing ability to process data.
You know, I wasn't going to be a good academic researcher, it was just... And I started thinking, like, well, what do I want to do? And so I just started applying to just, like, random things to see, like, the thought was, like, what am I disappointed at being rejected by, right? And one of them, I just sent off a packet to be the graphics intern at the New York Times.
You know, I think that the recent piece that she did showing the history of four-year deficit projections was really smart. My belief is it was her original idea to do that, to create what she's called the porcupine chart. The dominant line in this figure is what the federal deficit actually was. And then at different points in time when the projections were made, you know, she has created a line that shows what the projection was. And usually you see, I think she said in 70% of the cases, the projection was much more optimistic than where the deficit actually went. And you can see that in the chart. It's an important subject. And it's an interesting way to add this historical context.
One of the things that visualization is very helpful for in many cases is putting data in context. So I see a spike in government expenditures in the 90s and what happened, and you see, well, this is also when, you know, tax revenue spiked due to a good economy, like those types of descriptive annotations, which aren't, you know, present within the spending data itself, are critical to getting, you know, an appropriate understanding of what happened.
More recently, Amanda made a piece that let readers find different unemployment rates for different kinds of people.
Probably every newspaper in America has run the unemployment rate chart showing the unemployment rate ticking up to 10%. You can actually see that, you know, the unemployment rate varies incredibly between different groups. So if you are a college-educated white woman between the ages of 25 and 44, the unemployment rate for that group is, I think, about 3.5%, where if you're a young black male that's never graduated from high school, the unemployment rate is almost 50%.
I mean, for me, I think the highest goal is to, you know, sort of change what you think about the world, or to take something you already know and to make you think about it again for the first time.
Well, I would love to be able to hire, you know, a statistician or computer assisted reporter. We have some open positions now, and I would love for those positions to be geared towards somebody that had that skill set. Here's what the data is, and here's how we would want to shape this story based on this data.
So we've changed the focus of our team to concentrate more on database journalism. We've brought in people with data specialisms, we've brought in people who know GIS software and know how to work spreadsheets better than most designers do, in order to try and up our game in that particular level. So we started about a year ago, and we're in the process now of getting a data-based journalist in place.
We've done anything from the stimulus tracker, which was sort of a data-heavy project that we did in partnership with Onvia, who is gathering data about all of the contracts, all the government contracts that are being put out as a result of the stimulus money that's coming down. We mapped all of that data to locations and enabled people to sort through it and filter it by industry and that kind of thing. And the ultimate goal is to combine that kind of data with things like who voted for the stimulus and who didn't vote for it.
So in the past year, we've done a visualization on crash data, which was our journalists did a huge project in trying to get all fatalities across the UK from crashes. This data doesn't exist anywhere else, so it was quite a challenge to get hold of it. And then we've mapped it, we've charted it to see if there's any stories, any trends that come out of it, see if there's any black spots. We've got an ongoing Afghan casualties database and Iraq casualties database, which is plotting the deaths in the various war zones and the demographics of the people involved, which is quite a very emotional subject for people.
I think we're still in an early stage. I think a lot of the, you know, both artists and journalists are still very much exploring what the capabilities of data visualization are for communicating both the context and the narrative elements of a story.
We've got the similar challenges to other people. You know, it's how do you get the story from the data? It's how do you really interrogate that data and show it to the audience in the best way? When you just put a huge amount of data up there and let people interrogate it, we've user tested that to see how our audience react to it. On the whole, they like it, but they want more of a story there. They want to see what's the important thing. They want to know why they want to look at it.
Right now, it's very much what we do is a lot of just showing you the data and letting you draw your own conclusions, which is great to some extent, but it also requests or requires a lot of effort on the part of a user. And if a user gets frustrated, then, or it's just too much, and they're like, why am I doing this? You know, that's not serving the purpose that we wanted to serve.
Yeah, I do think that there's editing is a huge, 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 huge important thing, right? Like, and you know, I really like reject sort of, there's a web template of like, you know, you mock up your structure and then you like, you know, fill in the holes, right? But I think it's really important to look at your data first and to decide what's, you know, like to throw some of it away.
So we did this amazing, really beautiful visualization, data visualization of the Fortune 500, you know, these yellow circles with the, of showing the profit and the revenue of all the companies with the tickers, and really beautiful flower. But it was no story to it.
It's interesting, and we struggled, I think, online with the data is with having any kind of a narrative, not even a nonlinear narrative, but any kind of a narrative at all. Like I think of like that time, the time use graphic, right? You know, where we write one sentence about what you're seeing when you click on every button, right? You know, like, and you know, those sentences are, they're fine, they're adequate, but there's no real, like, they don't add to anything greater. They don't like build on each other. Like, and that part of the reason for that is because it's hard to do when you don't know, you know, when the whole point of it is like click whatever button you want.
I think that data visualization is becoming a phrase that doesn't mean as much as it should do. All it means is looking at numbers, which is what a lot of information graphics are, as far as I'm concerned. Now it seems that data visualization means visualizing a whole lot of data. And that's given rise to a trend that I think is damaging, because you can do beautiful things with computers and lots of data.
I don't know.
That look very, very nice and are almost completely incomprehensible.
So that would be true of a bad visualization. And you know, there's a lot of bad visualizations out there, just as there's a lot of bad infographics. I think there very much is a craft in this field. And if you do it wrong, you can get really bad results, just as there's a lot of poorly written stories out there.
The whole data visualization trend worries me when it's done badly, because what's happened is there've been a few very effective ones that have appeared widely around on blogs and everything, and then everybody's sort of jumping in now and having a go. And of course this is always a danger, because the principles that we've always used for graphics have to still be applied. You can't just start spinning up random things out of the numbers. We still got to tell that story very clearly.
We
We're very interested in how visualizations are being taken up in mass media, particularly in journalism. So we simply collected as many examples as that as we could, and then tried to analyze that. So break it down and see, you know, what type of narrative devices and story elements seem to be common across many of these different examples. You know, visualization as a medium for telling stories leverages a lot of the techniques that have been developed in other domains. And a lot of those things, whether it's in graphic art or in film, carries over to visualization. But there's also other aspects that you don't typically find in there, and I think interaction is key to that. I think this is probably true of narrative forms of video game as well. So martini glass is a term we actually found by looking around on the web and seeing what other people were saying about journalism. You know, having led people through a more strictly scripted story, you then open up the visualization for more exploration.
So if there was a way that we could confidently say, here's the data, and here, you can play with it all you want, but if you're not into that, here's a guided kind of interpretation of that that we felt comfortable with, I think that would be great.
Another idea was the interactive slideshow. You have some frame, and you advance from one frame to the other, and there may be some level of interaction within it. So people might click on elements of interest, they might have a timeline they can drag back and forth.
We do this with a lot of things, right? We call it the stepper, you know, like a little bit of like hand-holding about like, here's what you are seeing now, and then it plays.
The data slideshow was based on our research into having all data in one space and how our audience reacted to that. And the general perception was that there's too much information there. You've got about 4 or 5 seconds to capture the attention of the audience when they first come to your page. So by splitting it out into chunks, into sections, you can help engage them a little bit more by only giving them small chunks of information at any one given time. So if they are even remotely interested in it, they'll capture the first part of the information, click on next, and then as they move through it, they can get a better understanding. And most of the audience, sort of 50%, just look at the first slide thing. Well, that's all I need to know. But then for sort of 25, we'll then work through the rest of the slides and get a bigger picture. And we found that was a much more successful approach to trying to get across quite complex subjects than just give it a one static information.
There was one, another idea was one of a drill down story, which was instead of having a more scripted narrative, more linear in nature, you instead have some overview of a set of topics or elements of interest, and you might drill down. So an example might be, you know, for the recent Olympics, there may be different events, and so it begins with a map of the Olympic grounds, and then you might click on a certain region, it would zoom in and show you what events are happening, say, on Mount Whistler or on Blackcomb.
I think that's particularly for a news site like ours, that's how we end up with like the state-by-state map is kind of our default interface, where it's just like, you know, we can show you the big macro level, and then we can let you drill down to your particular county, that sort of a thing. But, you know, in a lot of ways, that's the information that people are interested in.
It's like allows some sort of navel-gazing, like everyone likes to, you know, if you want to look up your own neighborhood, people are always going to look up their own neighborhood no matter what it is.
The range of expressive potential of visuals that are representative of data is very high. That said, I don't think it's a medium that functions well in isolation.
I mean, there is a new trend where data visualization is meeting motion graphics, is meeting the narrative and the story. It isn't just numbers floating around that's very pretty to look at, but has zero context. That's the beauty of marrying these two things.
The crisis of credit, visualized.
When I saw that, I was just glued to my seat.
This means banks on Wall Street can borrow from the Fed for only 1%.
Not only for me was it just, it was cute, it was serious, it was all those things wrapped into one. But it was a bit entertaining, but the visuals were so strong and it made so much sense to me to be able to hear and see things.
And amongst the pages that I did, there was a thing about vampire energy. And they said, we'd like to make a little film about this.
You know, energy isn't free. A 60-watt light bulb kept on for a week costs just over a dollar.
Now here, to me, is the classic difference between print and what you can do on the web. I mean, you can tell a story. You've got words, you've got music, you've got silence, you've got movement, you've got sound effects. The thing that seemed now to look incredibly compressed on the page and actually a little complicated could now breathe and could you could lead people through the steps.
It would be equivalent to removing more than 18 million cars.
And show the lengths of things and talk about it. And that was a revelation to me, but it was an enormous amount of work.
We've recently just brought into the team After Effects Premiere some 3D animation software in order to be able to do more of that kind of video editing thing and that kind of motion graphics elements. And as I say, we're working closely with the TV graphics who have a huge skill base in motion graphics, but not necessarily a huge skill base in information graphics. So it's about bringing them two disciplines together and getting the best out of both in order to convey the information.
Just as people have done rich analyses of like photographic composition or film direction, etc., we're at the stage where I think it's time to start thinking about, you know, what sort of guidance do we bring to designers of visualization who are coming up. I think there's a whole generation of folks that are going to do great work.
Malofius is the most important news infographics gathering in the world. It has existed for the past 18 years, and every year here in Pamplona, in Spain, a lot of infographics people from all over the world gather and party, but at the same time they also talk about graphics, and it's really interesting. An awards thing, but it is also a summit where everybody shares ideas and we attend conferences and presentations. Unfortunately, infographics is something that is usually dominated by fashion. And the fashion that is going on right now, the one that is winning more awards right now, strange visualizations, I mean, strange looking graphic forms.
So the hierarchy is an important factor in graphics. Like, people show you this fantastic spiral, including tons of data, over 20 years worth of data about traffic incidents. And here's tweets. This is people saying good morning around the world. And you think, wow, this is really great. This tells me something about traffic incidents over the last 20 years. But then you realize it doesn't really. It's just this incredible looking image.
Whereas in the past, I think there used to be a lot more sort of narrative illustrated graphics. Now we're definitely seeing a big move toward more just statistic rich, you know, data driven pieces.
Tenemos con nosotros a Hannah Fairfield, que es editora de infografía de gráficos del New York Times en la oficina de Washington.
I wanted to take some risks. I wanted to take some design risks. And so I started thinking about how these variables are interrelated. So you can see that the height is whether or not people are able to pay or not pay their mortgages, and the color is how many subprime mortgages are.
When you talk us through it, it's wonderful. I'm with it. I'm really understanding the whole graphic as well as you have, and you built it. I worry, my editors worry, about are we taking the readers with us or are we losing them behind?
I knew that my readers were going to need a little bit of help with that. And so right up front, I said, how to read the chart.
Last year's Best of Show graphic, for example, is a strange-looking visualization. It's like a stream of colors that encode the ebb and flow of movies, how several movies did in the box office. It was published by the New York Times, and it's really attractive. It's really beautiful. It's graphically just gorgeous. And started trying to read it, and I couldn't understand anything.
Lee Byron was here a couple years ago. He's joined Facebook now, but he's, you know, the movie graph was some. That was his code.
So the technique that was in the movie box office visualization is, I think, the term that Lee came up with was a stream graph. It's a very beautiful, flowing graphic. And in many ways, it illustrates the kind of compromises you have to make in a visualization. First of all, it drew people in and got a whole lot of attention. It was also very good at showing sort of the overall shape of the data. But it did that by making a compromise in the sense that any individual time series in this, you know, looking at the box office receipts for one particular movie, that was harder than in a more traditional graphic.
I mean, it was very shallow. It was really difficult to extract deep meaning from that graphic. At the first level, engaging the reader with a nice looking graphic form, it works. It works perfectly. It really grabs your eye and makes you stop and try to decode it. But after that, it frustrates you.
I think we're just in a phase where we haven't quite figured out how to put these things forward to the average reader. And maybe it's just a transitional phase. I'm sure data visualization will be a powerful tool like many other tools in information graphics. It's just that right now, it's become like a cult trend. I mean, some of the people doing it are like rock stars.
You know, the illustrations that used to be important some years ago is going a bit down in favor of some more synthetic and clear representation of data. Definitely, I think that all infographic artists, we have to evolve a lot, you know, in this statistical area.
They were saying that all the Eastern European countries were voting for themselves, and all people were saying this. So I wanted to find out, is it really so? So I got the data from the European Broadcasting Union, and I put it together and started to figure out different ways to visualize it. I'm not sure what it's called, but I wanted to put them in a circle and divide them by East Europe, Western Europe, and those who didn't vote in the contest. So Eastern European countries were voting for themselves, but also the Western European countries were voting for the Eastern European countries.
I think what was recognized is that it was highly interactive, where there are variables, you know, that someone can choose from, and they can decide what they're interested in and then access the data that they're interested in. And it was executed very cleanly with simple strategic color use and, you know, clean typography, nice organization. And I think that's probably what people responded to.
Is it August 12th? Yes, worst sunburn ever. So the inside front cover is usually a typical theme. There are a couple of things I like to explore. One of them is this idea of personal temperature, based on where you were over the course of the year. What are the temperatures that you experienced? So I did this annual report of my life in 2005, where I sort of took an archaeological look at everything I'd done in the previous year, just scanning through my calendar and remembering the meaningful events, like the flights I took, and using Last.fm as a source. And I was able to put together this statistical view of my year, which I thought would be interesting to friends and family, and turned out to have a much broader appeal.
My first reaction when I first saw the Feltron report was, we don't care, do we? But you know, the thing is that it's more of an exercise in charting, and there's a great beauty in that, actually.
Okay, we have subway trips, 561. Foreign subway trips, 22. New York City taxi trips, 138. Foreign taxi trips, 13.
We don't care about his personal data, but actually, he treats the data with such a beautiful, precious way, and he does it so well. You can't help but like it.
He's right here. Teeth lost by a cat, 1. His canine on an unknown date.
I think it's great. I'm always excited to see what he comes up with. And I feel like it's also a reflection of how much data visualization is becoming a new expressive language.
His smartphone's pretty useful. Most of the time, it's not complex enough that I can't just write it down the next morning. iCal has been a great place to log things. And if things do get complex, like the year I was tracking every street that I walked down, there was a lot of smartphone typing it in and emailing it to myself. And then that one I would log in Illustrator. I would just draw the lines every day and make the map as I went. In a future that we're heading to where there are sensors everywhere and all this data is being produced, I feel I'm only, you know, a couple steps ahead of what will be done in an automated fashion for everyone.
I
the work that's being done now is kind of the first baby steps towards a world where it's not going to be really possible for you to have a major kind of, say, a cultural event without there being a corresponding kind of data visualization that goes along with it. We've been doing some work with MTV. What we put together was something that was looking again at Twitter traffic and the volume of Twitter traffic relative to the different stars that were at the Video Music Awards. You could start to do things like compare Taylor Swift to Kanye West.
Taylor Swift.
And those of you that pay attention to this kind of stuff probably know that he got up on stage and took her award away from her.
But Beyonce had one of the best videos of all time.
But then immediately afterwards, we started to see this kind of result from Kanye West of what people were talking about. So this idea that you can kind of, again, you can set these structures up that kind of immediately, you know, tell you who the asshole is a pretty vital part.
So far, we haven't done much data gathering in the sense of dynamic real-time collection. Things like, can we look at every tweet on a topic? Or can we look at every tweet that comes across the wire and then see if we can figure out in aggregate what people are talking about? You know, the ability to see what 100 million people are having for lunch in any given moment may or may not be interesting, but when those people start going out into the real world and start experiencing things and tweet picking planes that land on the Hudson, then, you know, that all of a sudden you can make the case that that's compelling news information.
There's a number of graphics that we do that just automatically update themselves based on data feeds from like business services or election results. There's a couple challenges in it. One is just because something is dumped out in a data feed, once again, doesn't mean you necessarily want to just visualize that straight as is. You have to think, all right, is this something that really is worth taking the time to visualize and let it run on an updated basis? The second challenge is that when you're building something to just update itself, you need to build it in a way so that you handle all of the edge cases. So that if the unemployment rate comes in incredibly high 1 month, your chart still displays something normal and doesn't end up drawing off the chart.
There are certain aspects of live data that are really exciting and really interesting, but I think it's also like, it by necessity, by definition, it's here is some data, colon, right?
You could almost see breaking news stories appearing in a data set, and I think that would be probably a few years off, but that would be amazing if it happens.
And so Google has a new product, which we hope will be helpful to us, as they do too, making public data more accessible and easier to analyze and visualize.
So these are users in English in US at a certain point in time. So their interest in, say, unemployment rate, the number two, is of course very high right now, but it might not have been so high 5 years ago. Health conditions, disasters, GDP, last names. People look for Irish last names. Today, we have launched data from the World Bank, triggered on top of the other search results, saying fertility rate world. And we give them the number 2.5, which is quite low in the historical context. You can see how it's decreasing. So numbers in isolation are often not that useful. You need the context, and if you're not an expert, you're not aware of the context. Is 2.5 high or low? So by showing the trend there, people can realize that since 1960, that's actually a very low number. Clicking this chart brings you to a page, we're actually live now, where world is selected, but we can easily add all the other countries we want to. Let's add the United States, and there you go. With two or three clicks, 5-6 seconds away, I can put them on a chart, and I can link to this chart, or I can embed it in my blog.
That device we just saw by Google could revolutionize what we try to do as investigative reporters, because, you know, by the nature of investigation, you're going so much deeper, and we are often doing that with deep data sets that are tailored to the specific investigation, and the problem has been trying to convert that data into pleasing, simple visuals on our websites.
And we've got a winner. Chlamydia overtook gonorrhea back in 1992, as we all know. I don't know why, but there is someone who knows why, and people deserve to find this data and those stories much, much easier. But to make it useful, there are explanations on the data. which needs to be created by someone who really understands the content. And that piece is really, really hard to scale up with technology. It requires a human brain to analyze the data.
You know, the key part of exploratory data analysis for many instances is being able to rapidly iterate. And so if it takes you a day or a week to build a visualization, that sort of time scale is just not going to support exploratory analysis. It's certainly not in a way that will meet with the hard deadlines that journalists face in the newsroom.
And it's contrary to the idea that I've said that editing is super important, that sketching is super important, that you have to learn how to sketch with data. Like, you try on, you know, 8 different formats and the first 7 don't really fit.
So oftentimes we use visualization as a way to get a much more qualitative sense of what's happening in the data, what are the different patterns, which then as we might move into more technical or mathematical approaches, we go, you know, armed with much deeper knowledge of what's going on.
This idea of enabling discovery, of kind of being able to look at the data and discover things in it that you wouldn't have necessarily even thought to look for, is a pretty important part of what we're thinking about at the studio. We're really trying to get away from this idea that you would kind of take a data set, wrap something around it, and then say, here are the conclusions, but make interfaces that allow you to explore and discover and to kind of ask questions that you wouldn't normally think to ask. It's a project called Crime Spotting, and it was started by my partner Mike, who was getting frustrated with the maps of Oakland that were available at the time. This is what a usual map of what the city of Oakland was providing as a map for their crime. I think there's a little bra in there for prostitution, and there's the red, you know, there's a little liquor bottle there. And the thing that I'm not showing here is the hoops that you have to jump through in order to get to this map. You basically have to fill out like the census form before you can get a map. What Mike did was to write a bunch of scripts that would go in and kind of extract the data from this map and pull it into something that looked a little more elegant and was a little bit more useful. And the idea is that crimes are kind of generally sorted into 3 types: murder on the red, narcotics in blue, and then theft and vehicle theft in green. On the bottom left, there's a timeline that you can drag and slide and all that. And it's the interface is such that you can start to do things like, you know, roll over a theft and you'll see all the thefts. Here are all the prostitution arrests in about a week period. About 3 days after we launched it publicly, the city of Oakland got freaked out and shut it down. Essentially, you know, kind of, it's called a denial of service. They basically wouldn't let our servers talk to their servers.
After having gone through this really provocational process of, you know, freeing the data in Oakland, San Francisco, while going through their whole, like, open data initiative, you know, basically came to us and said, hey, we would love to build crime spotting for San Francisco. Here is a KML file that you can use, and gave us, you know, as much crime data as we thought would be necessary. But only after, you know, sticking it into crime spotting and building the site and then, like, pushing it out, and, you know, the 24 hours before the big SF data press release, did we realize that it didn't have alcohol or prostitution or homicide incidents. And, you know, I mean, so completeness is, you know, a really important aspect of this stuff.
As a typical journalist, I'm, you know, naturally skeptical about how far people are going go. I mean, usually the outs talk about accessibility and openness, and when they get inside, they find that they have secrets that they want to keep.
You know, even the government data, I still am waiting for somebody to do some really strong analysis of the data.gov data. I mean, that's the neat thing right now, right? Is transparency is the new black.
One of the things about visualization is that it definitely can promote openness just by the fact of it existing, because the moment you try to make a visualization, you realize you need data, and if you have holes in your data, they can become apparent. And so visualization really can serve 2 roles. One is the explicit role of letting us see stuff coming. The other is this sort of funny passive-aggressive role that if you need to do a visualization, you find yourself pushed into the mode of wanting to make data open.
I think there's a really interesting challenge, and how do you design the right sort of development and design environment for creating interactive visualizations.
Most of the interactive graphics we do, or at least the ones that involve animation or the really heavy data visualization, are done in Flash.
I might use technologies like Java. Flash is the one that's most successful, or things like Microsoft Silverlight. That basically, you know, it's a computer program that then gets embedded within the web page and runs there. And there's been lots of success with that, particularly because Flash is so available in browsers.
At the moment, if you want to publish that, there's really nothing out there that's better. I imagine that as HTML and JavaScript and the canvas tags get better, there may be less of a need for Flash, but I don't think that at the moment it's going to go away anytime soon. I think one of the things that surprised me the most about how we've begun to work as a graphics department is in many ways how much of like a software development shop we've also become. When we first started out, it was much more of like you approached everything on a one-off basis. And it quickly became apparent that if you wrote a whole slew of code to do maps showing election results, you really needed to build that code in a way that could be reused for other projects.
There are libraries and toolkits out there that have been crafted to make the process of creating visualizations less painful. And in that realm, two things from Jeff Hare come up. So Flare, which is a set of libraries for Flash, for Flex, and Protoviz, which just came out, which is for JavaScript.
So Protoviz is the language we've created for visualization design. And how it works is it assumes that there's, you know, a number of different basic shapes. So things like bars or plotting symbols or areas. And then those get, you know, data sets get mapped into those shapes. And so basically it's a language for saying what properties of the data should then be realized as properties of those graphic marks. And so far we found that it's enabled at least us within our lab and then the designers and hobbyists, et cetera, that we've been working with are able to create visualizations with remarkably less effort, you know, less code, and oftentimes expressing, you know, a lot more pleasure with the results.
If you go to the website, there's a bunch of really beautiful examples, recreation of classic examples of information visualization and graphics.
Examples are incredibly important for multiple reasons. Examples show the different types of visualizations that are possible. So for a design sense, it kind of enriches people's thinking about what are the available options and what are the right ways to convey data. And from the technical side, it provides examples of how to create these visualizations. How do you write the little bit of code necessary to bring this visualization to life?
So we're very excited about, you know, what does it mean to sort of break away from even Flash and see what you can do with straight JavaScript. The promise of, you know, write it once and let it run everywhere, it's closer.
It runs well on the iPhone. It'll run well on, you know, Google Android phones. And a number of the other technologies, including Flash, that are very popular, you know, in desktop, laptop applications, won't necessarily be available on mobile platforms. And so looking forward, some of these browser-native techniques may be the better bet in terms of reaching a wide diversity of interactive devices.
The New York Times is unique. Other newspapers don't have 30 people. And the thing I think a lot of places can do is, I think building tools is really important. I mean, the more you automate something, the less like interesting and unique it is by definition, but I think tool building is really important.
The Texas Tribune is a nonprofit organization in Texas. They have a mapping system set up where they can put in different shapefiles and different data that will map county level data across Texas. And so it's just a Flash system that accepts an input that will just automatically map whatever's put on it. The idea is that you build one thing that can be used multiple times so that you get better return on your investment.
My team has built a bunch of templates. They're all Flash-based templates. And then there's a data entry form that's sort of pseudo part of our CMS.
It enables editors to input data in a form-based interface, and then when you publish it, it spits out an XML document that then we can pull into our Flash-based interactives.
We have a timeline template. We have line charts, bar charts, columns, and those have various features like the ability to have multiple lines or multiple bars or grouped columns, you know. And we have mapping. You can zoom in to, say, counties from our national map. We can pair up our timeline with our map. So if we have the average birth rate in every state since 18 whatever, whenever they started keeping it until now, we can show that change over time. So that's pretty cool.
Monde.fr, on a un outil de gestion qui permet de mettre en ligne qui s'appelle le set. Et à l'intérieur de ce set, on a plusieurs outils graphiques. Donc un qui permet de générer des cartes, un qui permet de générer des graphes, un qui permet de générer des résultats pour les élections. On a plusieurs comme ça. Pour que la rédaction puisse créer une carte et l'afficher sur le site de cette façon-là, on a un outil dans le set qui nous permet à base d'une API Google, de générer une carte de situation. Donc notre outil est assez simple, hein, il suffit d'indiquer un lieu, Paris par exemple, de l'ajouter sur la carte, et à partir de là, on peut éditer ce point par un titre, un texte de description, et également lui associer une icône. Donc là, c'est pas. J'espère que ça ne se passera pas. Donc on a des cartes un peu plus fournies, comme celle-ci. Vous voyez, là, on peut vraiment afficher énormément de points. Alors, un graphe, on a ici. Donc c'est la balance commerciale en France pour 2009. Donc ça, c'est l'interface qui permet de créer le graphe. Tout ce qui est base de temps, valeur max et min sur la base de valeurs, ça nécessite aucune formation. C'est des outils très simples qui sont mis à leur disposition. Plutôt que d'utiliser des outils graphiques comme Illustrator pour créer directement une courbe ou autre, on leur donne une interface web qui permet de générer cette courbe.
Now it may be that it'll always involve some level of, if not coding, at least some programming knowledge to understand how to construct these things. Because in the deal, they are transforming data, you are doing interactions, so there's all these rich operations involved. But there's still a question of, well, how much of that can be brought into a way that's more directly explorable and manipulable. You know, in the future, maybe it'll look like some strange hybrid of Excel and Illustrator and then something else that hasn't even been thought of yet. But how can we take these concepts and, translate it to make that design even more accessible, those design options accessible to a wider array of folks?
There's a lot of things out there now that don't require a lot of technical skill to use, but you can still get the message across, things like many eyes and swivel and those types of things, which are a fantastic starting point. I've been using swivel lately for basic chart visualization and graphs and stuff. Google Charts, when I do development and I just want really easy, quick charts to show up on a page that I build, I use Google Charts. There's Wordle, if you want word clouds to be easily generated, they're kind of static. Many eyes is another good example.
It's so easy for people to do their own now. Like, I have two reporters now who just figured out how to use swivel. And so instead of being like, I have this Excel sheet, can you post it to the site? They're putting it in Swivel, they're posting the doc data for everybody, and then they're making their own bar charts, which is great.
A lot of like Swivel and Wagini and these kinds of things have at least a basic tutorial, if not a code repository and a forum.
The level of sophistication in a map that a lay cartographer can make just by using Google products, easily accessible on the web, it's pretty astonishing. What you can actually do just making use, if you know kind of how you want to combine some of those things and make use of them.
You need knowledge in social science, you need to know the tools, you need to know your target group, and you should be addicted to technology and you should have a kind of a vision.
For people who are entering this now, they should play to their strengths. There's not just one kind of person doing this sort of thing. As I mentioned, there are people who are specializing different ways, who make maps, who make animated diagrams, who deal with data.
From an educational standpoint, I think, in addition to graphic design and computer programming are all very helpful, but a knowledge of statistics is also critical to doing this well. And so I expect that each of those will be things in the tool belt of this next century's journalists.
I mean, I think the start is like do it with a subject you're comfortable with, do it with something you know, do it with something that you care about. Just probably super generic advice. That's like the bar chart of advice. And I think you just get started with one, right? Like, and then you build on that as it grows.
While you obviously need to know enough technology, be it whatever form you want, Flash, HTML, JavaScript, processing, and so on, to actually like you really want to think a lot about like what is important to show here and how can I design it in a way that's clear and like brings across the point of the story I'm trying to tell. Just because it's just you, that doesn't mean that you're never going to be able to pull it off. There are a lot of people who can pull off a lot of amazing things by themselves.
To keep abreast of what's happening nowadays, one, there's a real active blogosphere. So blogs like Infosthetics, Flowing Data, Visual Complexity, and there's many others that I've left out. A great place to keep up with kind of interesting discussions and debates within the field. A little more academically, there's a conference called the IEEE Information Visualization Conference, and that's one of the primary venues in which researchers are publishing papers about what they see as the state of the art of visualization and where they share new technologies that are being developed.
It's a weird time. It used to be we have to explain to people what DIG was and what visualization was, and now, we're getting calls from, name your cable station that are like, we hear the data visualization is to be found here. So it's kind of, it's a little strange actually. It's becoming a little checkbox on people's media plans. I'm not sure if I think that's the best thing ever or the worst thing. I'm leaning towards it being the best thing ever.
I think you see really interesting groups doing fantastic work, like the folks at Stamen Design in San Francisco. Is it a whole movement? It's a bit hard to say because I think we're still in a really nascent stage, but I'd say the initial signs are very positive.
I think that we're kind of, all the stuff that we're doing now is kind of just in the early days of cinema.
So what you see is this incredibly fluid flow of ideas, and to me that's really what's exciting, is that maybe 15 years ago there were these very distinct silos and people in completely different fields had no idea what they were, that everyone was working toward the same thing. But today it's starting to fuse. It's fun, it's competitive. We look around all the time and we're like, where is the next, amazing thing gonna come from? Over here, over there? And we feel like, okay, the need to keep up, it's very energizing and enjoyable.
And it shows the length of the day. They're the months of the year, it's a calendar.
Data visualization is here to stay, no question about it. It's not some passing fad that we're gonna stop doing in about a year's time. In fact, we're just gonna take it and it's going to become part of the whole information graphics package, no question about it. So we better all get on board.